This is not the talk show with expert guests analyzing the presidential campaign. This is the talk show hosted by the expert on the presidential campaign, Eric Erickson, every night on News Talk WSB.
Welcome back to the program. Things just seem randomly amiss all of a sudden. I'm going to be on CNN now, spur of the moment, at 10 o'clock tonight, AC360, talking about Michelle Bachmann. At the top of the hour, we're going to delve into Michelle Bachmann's race. The media came out today, and in fact, I'm going to play my audio, angrily rebutting some of the anchors on CNN this morning. It was somewhat ridiculous. They're using, and you're hearing about this in the media today, oh, Michelle Bachmann, she's gaffe-prone. PolitiFact, the left-wing hackery, Pulitzer Prize-winning, just like Walter Duranty site, is out saying, oh, she makes all these false statements. When you actually look at the statements PolitiFact is attributing to Michelle Bachmann, she is quoting the media. In one case, she's quoting a New York Post article. In another, she's quoting a Center for Public Integrity article. And in both cases, she's quoting the articles, and the articles happen to get the information wrong, and PolitiFact to say Michelle Bachmann's a liar for daring to quote the media. First, they attack Sarah Palin for not reading the newspaper. Now they're attacking Michelle Bachmann for reading the newspaper, apparently. In any event, getting into presidential politics tonight, I have asked and was graciously told yes, Chris Ciccola, former congressman from Indiana, who is now the head of Club for Growth, one of only four organizations, conservative organizations in America that I would actually go to bat for at all costs. They're a fantastic organization. One day we'll delve into my list, but there are only four in America organizations that I truly love on the right. Club for Growth being one of them. Chris, welcome. Glad to have you.
Hey, Eric. Great to be on. Thanks for your support.
Yeah, absolutely. So you guys are doing white papers, and I have been diligently reading these white papers as they come out. My first question is, you're turning these out so fast. Are you outsourcing them to like some sweatshop in Bombay to get them out so fast?
No, our crack staff of, we're a big organization with 10 people. And we don't do anything but write them ourselves. And so it's, it's kind of a fun exercise we do every 4 years. And it's an educational process. It's primarily intended for our members so they can be informed voters in the primary process. But they're open to anybody who wants to read them. They can go to our website at clubforgrowth.org, and they can pick through them and decide what candidate they like. We try to be objective. We focus strictly on their economic record, and we try to cut through what they say and actually look at what they did in their political career. Not all of them, like Herman Cain, has a political career, so we look at his statements and what he's done in his business life. But it's a lot of fun. It's educational, and we even learn something ourselves.
Well, I was going to ask you on that point. For example, on Newt Gingrich or Michelle Bachmann, they have in their career taken conflicting positions on different issues. Romney, for example, in 2003, I believe it was in your report. It's been a couple of weeks since I've looked at it, but that it was in 2003, Romney actually was opposed to George Bush's tax cuts. He's now on the campaign trail saying he embraced the Bush tax cuts. How do you guys handle evolution of a position over time?
Well, we look at candidates and see if they've learned from their mistakes. And Romney is a special case. He is, as you point out, he has taken different positions on different issues consistently, not just our issues, but other issues.
And the one consistency.
Well, I think on Red State, you've got a video actually posted there that has some of those inconsistencies very clearly pointed out. But what we try to do is just let people read the facts, and there's some color as to our likes and dislikes. I'm sure comes through on the paper because we are advocates of economic freedom, and we want the candidates to be the same. And so we'll be critical when they show some inconsistencies or lack of support of those issues. But we really do try to let people make those decisions. Romney not only opposed the Bush tax cuts when they originally passed and now says he would make them permanent, but he also, he also criticized Steve Forbes and the flat tax. And so there are some things to give us concern with Governor Romney's past. And we don't see necessarily that he has learned or embraced those mistakes and said, okay, I've learned something, let's move on. Tim Pawlenty, on the other hand, has coined the phrase clunkers. He says that he's learn from those things and wants to never make those mistakes again, which I think is a pretty smart strategy. But again, it's for people to decide for themselves whether that's sincere.
Well, you've been in politics for a while. You're a congressman. Now you're at the Club for Growth. Do you see any, anything striking about this year's presidential season so far, other than the fact that it's just taken forever for people to kind of, maybe it's not taken forever. We haven't even gotten to the primaries and caucuses yet, but it just seems like there's still angst out there about the field.
There is angst, and I guess what's, extraordinary is the lack of enthusiasm for a single candidate. And, you know, there's no obvious choice for us. We have not endorsed anyone. We, you know, like a little bit and dislike a little bit about all the candidates. So, you know, we are accused sometimes for pitching a particular candidate and criticizing the others. And my response is, I wish I was pitching for a particular candidate. I wish there was somebody that we were really excited about and could really get behind, because we want to be for somebody. And so, you know, we'll let the process go through. We'll see if somebody really emerges with a clear message. But at this point, we haven't really lined up behind anybody because, you know, we just don't think there is an obvious choice.
Well, you know, I want to switch gears just slightly, because it seems like reading this week that there are some groups out there, particularly in the media, trying to draw you guys into a fight over this tax issue on Capitol Hill. And I think you guys have been much more sound than, for example, ATR on a willingness to consider getting rid of special tax exemptions and tax deductions carved out. Where does Club for Growth, when you look at tax policy in the country right now, where are you guys at on this in this fight over tax reform?
Well, I think you're referring to the Tom Coburn Amendment eliminating subsidies for ethanol and tariffs against ethanol importation into the United States. You know, we look at that and we look at the totality of the circumstances and concluded that getting rid of that subsidy and getting rid of the tariff is good for economic growth. It's a market-distorting tariff subsidy that is not based on free market decisions and consumer decisions. So we just thought that, there is some tax impact, but when you look at the benefits over the detriments, that the benefits far outweigh. And so, you know, we think that, getting rid of market-distorting credits and tax policy is a good thing when it results in better decisions, more efficient allocation of capital, and economic growth. And that's what we think and concluded in the ethanol subsidy battle.
Well, Chris, when I was in college, I'm not making this up. When I was in college, the first political organization that I joined was Club for Growth. In fact,
you were the very first man in college, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I was one of those heartless conservatives on a college campus. In fact, the first guy, when I was a lawyer, the very first political donation I ever gave was to Jeb Hensarling, because I got a list from Club for Growth, and he was on there, and I liked him, and I sent him money. How can people join the Club for Growth?
Well, people can go to our website at clubforgrowth.org. They can become members. There are they don't have to contribute if they don't want. We do survive on the generosity of our members. But what we are, 55,000 Americans from all walks of life, all 50 states, they really just believe in one thing, that pro-growth economic policy leads to prosperity for everyone and has really led to the strongest economy and greatest nation on earth. And so we just try to run a campaign, and economic freedom is our only candidate, and we look for champions of economic freedom that we can support through our PAC that are running for Congress. And as our first president, Steve Moore, who's now with the Wall Street Journal, used to say, we're just trying to improve the gene pool of Congress. And so,
well, you guys have an impressive win-loss record, though. I mean, how do you get into these races? Because when you look at a lot of organizations who get into a lot of races, you guys get in there, but more often than not, you win.
Well, we do win more often than not. I don't, frankly, know what our win-loss record is, because that's not our primary motivation, because we almost always get involved with non-establishment candidates, people who aren't expected to win, that can't, the establishment, frankly, thinks they can't win. As an example, we were one of the first to endorse Marco Rubio in Florida. He was 30 points down to Charlie Crist when we polled the race the first time in the summer of 2009. But we knew that if people heard Marco Rubio's message, that he could win. Our members responded very generously and got him substantial amounts of money early on, and so he was viable and could deliver that message. And he took it from there. He obviously turned out to be a great candidate and took care of his race relatively early. But people like Pat Toomey when he was running against Arlen Specter. And so we have a history of basically being on the other side of the establishment. Our members typically don't support the party committees because they're a little suspicious that the party committees will support folks that they don't think share their beliefs. But we do a vetting process. We take our endorsements very seriously and try to act like a good housekeeping seal of approval for fiscal conservatives for our members and encourage them to support them and help them get in office and make the country a little better place.
Well, Chris, I appreciate you taking the time to be with me tonight. Again, they can go to clubforgrowth.org to find the white papers on the presidential candidates and to be a member.
That's right. Yeah, they can find that, and they can find all kinds of interesting stuff. And, hey, I just want to thank you. I've really enjoyed posting on Red State. It's been kind of fun. I'm not a prolific poster, but once in a while I like to get on there and share our thoughts. So I appreciate that opportunity.
Absolutely. I enjoy having you. Thanks very much, Chris.
Sure. Thanks, Eric.
Chris Ciccola, former congressman of Indiana and now the president of the Club for Growth.